YouTube, this is Marco. Thanks so much for joining me for another video, another collection review. So let's roll the intro and jump straight into it. Alrighty, so taking a look at this collection, this is for Jay. Pretty impressive collection, although I will admit there are a few watches in there that I think most would consider kind of hyped up watches, a lot of, you know, somewhat obvious choices. So from left to right, we're looking obviously at a Panda Daytona, a Rhodium Dial Yachtmaster, a Wimbledon Datejust, this one with a Jubilee bracelet, and a just a regular kind of non-fluted bezel, if you will. We've got an Air King, and last but not least, we've got the 15450 Royal Oak with a blue dial. To me, that is the best Royal Oak. It's the 37 millimeter, so at least it fits my wrist better. I know it's technically the ladies model, but I definitely think all men can pull it off. I think this one or the 15300, the 39 millimeter, are definitely the two best to get because the size is just much more ideal for everyday wear. But yeah, the 37 fits my wrist perfectly. I think it's a beautiful watch, wonderful. And yeah, great collection overall. So let's dive into his story a little bit. Jay is a finance professional who's been collecting for about 10 years, which is important to take into consideration because I think once you reach a certain stage in your kind of collecting journey, I think you just go after the pieces you want and you don't really care for, you know, some of these other pieces out there. He's owned watches from many brands, but has consolidated to mostly watches from Rolex and AP because they speak to him the most. Makes sense. Both Rolex and AP make wonderful watches. He recently fell out with an AD, but is seeking to establish a relationship with a new one. Now, I think that ultimately makes sense because it's always good to have kind of an AD relationship. Although I will admit, as I kind of go on in this collection review, I don't really feel it's necessary, but hey, it's totally up to you. And last but not least, he's looking to sell a watch, namely the Yachtmaster, the Air King, or the Datejust, to ultimately get a 126710 BLRO, which is a Pepsi. And so he's asking what to sell. Well, first and foremost, looking at this collection, I'll be honest, I think adding a Pepsi to this kind of makes it a little more, you know, a little more of a hype collection, right? It's kind of the watches every Tom, Dick, and Harry off the street wants, right? A Panda, a Pepsi, and a Royal Oak. And to me, ultimately, I would almost never recommend in good conscience somebody pay, you know, the current market price, which are 30,000 US for a Pepsi. I think those are outrageous prices that, you know, you're approaching some extremely serious watches for like 5,000 more. We're in, you know, kind of manual wine chronograph territory, at least Corn de Vache territory, right? So to me, it just kind of makes no sense to really pay that amount of money for Pepsi. But again, it comes back to this idea that you have been collecting watches for 10 years. And ultimately, you know, I think you're reaching a point where you just want to go after the pieces you want, which makes sense, even though it's not the approach that I would go after. I don't want, you know, kind of the hype watches, the watches that everybody wants. But I think if it's what you want, I don't see a reason or a scenario why you shouldn't go after it, because ultimately, even if I were to recommend something else, it just wouldn't satiate your appetite, right? You wouldn't feel satisfied. And that would ultimately be worse, right? It would be worse for me to recommend a watch that you just don't want, or, you know, that is supposed to kind of be a filler, but ultimately still makes you lust after and desire another watch. So the watches I would personally get rid of really is two watches. I would get rid of both the Wimbledon Datejust and the Air King. I think both are, you know, somewhat unnecessary, at least the Datejust for sure, because, you know, it's kind of a slate dial, another rhodium dial type watch. Obviously, it's really kind of a rarer Datejust, maybe one of the rarer kind of dial configurations. And I definitely think that once they discontinue it, it will become, you know, somewhat collectible. But I just don't think it makes sense with the Yachtmaster. The two kind of conflate with one another. The Yachtmaster, in my opinion, is much nicer, much more luxurious, kind of submariner, if you will, but just a beautiful watch. I would definitely keep that over the Datejust. And I would also sell the Air King because I think within that collection, I don't know if the Air King really belongs, right? I don't know if you need a wind and wear a watch, although it's nice to have those brushed, that brush bracelet. You could just wear the Daytona or the Royal Oak or the Yachtmaster, you know, on a kind of everyday basis. So the Air King will ultimately, in my opinion, kind of become an afterthought. I think it's a great watch and it's something that's worthy in anybody's collection. But I think in this collection, it doesn't really make sense and it helps you ultimately bite the bullet of buying that Pepsi, right? So this is what your collection would look like after those kind of moves, right? So you would have obviously the Panda Daytona, the Rhodium Yachtmaster, the 50 and 450, and last but not least, you'd be adding the Pepsi. Now, again, it's not really a collection I personally enjoy. I think this is way too many sports watches. You have three watches, you know, the Daytona, the Yachtmaster, and the Pepsi, which are all somewhat, you know, somewhat similar looking in design, and, you know, kind of, I don't know, they're just not for me, in my personal opinion. This is where I would really alter your collecting strategy, if I'm being completely honest. From here, I don't know if I'd even look to collect another watch from Rolex, to be perfectly honest. I mean, I don't know if there's anything I can honestly recommend from them. I wouldn't recommend a Milgauss. I certainly wouldn't recommend, you know, an Explorer 2 or an OP, right? What are you going to go after? A Tiffany OP from your authorized dealer or some kind of precious metal Rolex? I think it just kind of takes your collection to a more hyped territory. I don't like the direction to be heading in that case. And so I don't really know if it's good to establish a new AD relationship, or if it's worth, maybe not good, but it's not worthwhile, because I don't know if there's any watch I would actually recommend you ask to get from an AD, except for the reason ultimately to kind of flip it or take advantage, you know, financially of the current Rolex situation. So I ultimately just wouldn't even consider establishing an AD relationship, and just try and move on to other pieces that ultimately I feel are far more impressive. And the one I'd recommend is from AP. It's one that is starting actually to become a little overlooked and disrespected, in my opinion. I had the opportunity to see this watch up close and personal in London at Selfridges, actually. And I think, listen, the original release of these watches, and the watch I'm talking about are the Code 1159, the original releases of these watches are, you know, I'll just be honest, they're ugly, right? I think the dials are way too plain. Sure, the case shape is interesting, what have you, but it's just not a nice watch. But these watches, the newer ones with these kind of fume, almost Moser-style fume dials, I think are really spectacular. I think it works super well with that kind of concave, let me just pull up this picture, that kind of concave case shape and glass shape. I think the case is super interesting. Obviously, you have that Royal Oak mid-case with the sculpted lugs. The movement is fantastic. One thing to note of this is there's a lot of kind of pointy areas in the actual bridges themselves, which is something a lot of big brands kind of stray away from, because, you know, beveling to a point is actually quite difficult. So this is a really impressive watch, both finishing wise, but, you know, I think it's super interesting from a case wise, a design perspective. And the dial itself is really quite interesting. I think it's super nice. I would go personally for the rose gold blue dial. That was my favorite from the ones that I'd seen. Although I do like as well the red gold, or sorry, the white gold with the burgundy style dial. I think it's really nice as well, and something a little off the beaten path and different. But this is ultimately my pick. I think you can go for the chronograph or the three-hander, but personally, you know, I would save yourself the expense. Obviously, it isn't a cheap watch, but on the secondary market, these have become, you know, pretty soft. They're selling at about retail, right? So they were only released about a year or two ago. So if you can pick these up, you know, 15, maybe even 20% off retail in the next couple of years after kind of saving up a little bit after the Pepsi purchase, I think this would be a really worthwhile addition to your collection, because it kind of takes away from, in my opinion, the hype of your collection, right? It's not so much a hype watch. I think it's from a brand that you really like, which is, you know, AP. You can even potentially explore getting this from an AD and then ask for a Royal Oak, you know, like a 15500, if you will, and then cash in on that if you want to. But yeah, I would chase something a little different, a little off the beaten path, because ultimately, I don't like the direction your collection is headed in, and I'm just being honest, Jay, right? I have to be honest in my review, because it's just becoming a very hyped up collection. I want to see you add something that's a little more unique, a little more personal, a little more you to the collection, right? Not something that, you know, others are telling you to purchase. Even though you may like those watches, that's fair. I don't know if that's the direction I want you to head in, right? I don't want you to add more watches that people tell you should add to the collection. I want you to figure that out for yourself and ultimately get, you know, kind of watches that I think are unique and beautiful and ultimately would be much better suited in your collection and add a lot more variety and diversity. You don't have a dress watch. I think the Code really makes sense. It's from a brand that you really like. And these ones are starting to become a little underappreciated. I think you can get these for a phenomenal discount on the secondary market. They're totally worth it. And people should definitely look out for these. So yeah, that's my collection review. I hope you guys enjoyed, and I hope you liked my suggestions. This is what Jay's collection would look like. Again, very impressive, you know, not a cheap collection by any means, but I'm really hoping that he kind of strays away from the hype watches, if you will. So yeah, thanks so much for watching, guys. This is Marco, and I'll see you guys in the next video. Make sure to like, comment, and subscribe. Thanks so much.